This video is sponsored by me. We have courses teaching you how to make better sound and lighting for your videos over at school.learnlightandsound.com, link down below. In video production, mixing sound consists of two main things. Number one, combining sound from several different sources, several different microphones, each person having their own microphone, and balancing them so that they sound good to the audience. That's the first thing. Number two, when we are mixing, we are also processing and routing our audio, or routing, depending on the time, the part of the world that you're in. That's really beyond the scope of what we're going to cover here, but I just want you to understand what mixing is. It's a lot of different things. All right, let's jump into gain versus trim versus faders and why we have all these different settings. First, for all practical purposes, gain and trim are the same thing. Now, there's some nuance there. We're not going to get into that, but those two things you can just assume in the context of this discussion about field recorders, field audio recorders, the gain and trim basically do the same thing. And gain is what happens in a recorder's preamplifier. It takes a microphone signal, which is a very small signal, and amplifies it. It makes it stronger. And it takes it to a stronger level that we typically refer to as line level. Now, line level is really kind of a range, but the idea here is that this line level is how most recorders are designed to handle and record audio. So no matter where what you're working on, which recorder you're using, there is some level of amplification, some level of gain or trim that happens in the recorder somewhere. And that's the first thing we're going to talk about. It's usually a setting on most recorders. There are just a few exceptions. Now, the idea is that you set the gain before you start recording. And the way you do that is you get each microphone channel to roughly the same level. That is to say, you get each of the channels, which is related to a microphone, which is related to a person. So you get all of those to roughly the same level on the meters. And you do this by first setting the fader to zero. We'll come back to what the fader is in just a moment, but you set the fader to all the different channels, all the different microphones for all the different people to zero. And then you adjust the gain while the people talk into their microphones. And you usually aim to adjust the levels so that the meters top out at a healthy level, well above the noise floor of the room, because there's always some level of noise in every room, but also leaving some room for the person to get louder without the meter going all the way up to the very top at 0 dB. This is called gain staging. And on quality field recorders, I typically suggest that you aim for the meters for any channel to top out at about minus 18 dB, and certainly no more than minus 12 dB, at least on quality modern recorders. Now, the reason we leave that room, and we call that headroom, the reason we leave that room is that in case that person laughs loudly or starts screaming or yelling. And what that does is it gives them enough room for the audio to be captured and not hit up against 0 dB and not distort. Whenever the meters get up to 0 dB, you're going to start getting distortion. So that's the first thing. So that's gain and trim. What about faders? What do they do? Here's the most important thing you need to know about faders, and that is that the purpose of faders is to make a mix. That's the important thing. So where gain is just to get the level to a healthy, recordable level, a fader is used to mix the sound from several different microphones together so that they sound coherent together. So your audience isn't going to have to crank their volume up to hear one person and crank it back down when another loud person starts talking back up and so on and so forth. It should sound seamless. It should be like a normal conversation where people are talking in a sane fashion. So when you are actively mixing during a recording, you use the fader to achieve two main things. Number one, it allows you to attenuate or reduce the level of any of the microphone channels. So you can use that to kind of balance everyone out. So for the loud talkers, you might pull their fader down a little bit. For the softer talkers, you might push their fader up just a touch. That's one thing. The fader also sends that microphone channel's audio to the mix at the level you've set the fader. So they're kind of the same thing, but that's what you're doing. You're making a mix with the faders. Now, you use those faders during the recording to make everything sound right together, to sound balanced. The other thing is that when you have somebody in the show that you're recording, Say, for example, you're doing a podcast, a video podcast, and there's somebody in the show who's not going to talk most of the time during the podcast. They're only going to be in one section, for example. You should pull their fader down for the entire time that they are not talking. And the reason for that is that it will make a cleaner mix. You'll have less noise in your mix because every time you have a microphone that's open and being recorded into the mix, that microphone is capturing room noise. It's capturing people talking who are talking into other microphones. They're in the same room, but their sound is making it over to this third person's microphone. And it's just adding noise and weirdness to the overall mix. So if somebody's not talking for a while, pull their fader down. It will sound better. So that's what a fader does. Now you understand gain, trim, and fader. Next question, why do some recorders have both gain and fader, or trim and a fader? We've already basically answered that, and that is because they are basically mixers, and they can also do something that's really kind of special. They can record both the isolated channels, the standalone microphones, to their own track. Each one goes to their own track. And when they do that, they're recording it at the level you have the gain set out, and they're completely ignoring the fader. The only thing the fader affects is the recorded mix, the total mix. So in these cases, you're recording what are called isolated channels, plus you're recording the mix. So you get the best of both worlds. And if you do a good job mixing during the recording, in post-production, you have a lot less work to do. Now, there's a big question that a lot of you are probably asking, and that is, why would I ever bother trying to mix during a recording when I can just do that in post-production? And that's a fair question. And that may be exactly what you should do if that's the thing that works best for your workflow. But here are a few situations where it actually makes more sense to actively mix during the recording. Number one, obviously, live shows. If you're doing a live stream, a live presentation that's also being recorded, you have to have good sound during the recording itself because it's live. People are watching it right then. So you have to mix and you need to do the best possible job you can there to make the best experience for your audience. Number two, even if the show is not live, for productions where you won't have a lot of time in post, or you won't have any time for post-production, you also need to mix during recording. And that's just going to make it easier for you to deliver on time. So you have to at least try. You may miss, and you can still record isolated channels and go fix something really quickly if you need to in post, but it's best to do a mix while you're recording. Now, there's a third situation I want to call out. Even if you will have all the time in the world for your post-production, some people still try to avoid pushing all of this mixing work to post-production because they can finish their video sooner. It just accelerates the overall process. And once you learn how to mix, you can get a really great sounding mix during your recording. And there may be times when you miss, and you can still record isolated channels on your recorder if your recorder supports that. And a lot of the modern ones do, including the MixPre, including the Zoom F-Series recorders, including things like the podcast recorders from Rode and Mackie. So you can do that, but if you can get the mix right during the recording, less work in post-production. But Curtis, what about my fancy Dingbell 3000 XL 32-bit float recorder? I don't have to set gain on that, so why do I even care? All right, that's a different video. And the reality is you still need to understand what your recorder is doing because at some level it's doing gain or trim, it's doing amplification, and there are faders on those recorders as well. So you still need to understand, maybe go look at the block diagram in the documentation for your recorder to understand how it's doing it so you can get the best possible results. And we can cover that in more detail in other videos, and we cover it in our courses as well. So there are still important things for 32-bit float recorders. It's not like 32-bit float solves all problems. So get that out of your mind if you're thinking that. All right, that's a lot. We covered a lot. Let that sink in for a bit. Make sure you keep your eye on the channel here. We are going to have more videos where we dig into more depth so you can become a better audio mixer. In the meantime, get out there and make some great sound. Talk to you again soon.